on its stem right here to prevent the mercury from going back into the bulb after it is removed from the patient's mouth. This is how an accurate reading may be obtained. Okay, fellow physics teachers, we have a novel temperature detector here. This is called a liquid crystalline strip, and it works in the same principle as your mercury and your alcohol thermometers. The strip is placed in the person's head to detect the temperature, and the part here that lights up corresponds to the temperature reading. Okay, now, so a sensitive device which measures temperature is called the thermistor here, and this is often used in electronic circuits. Okay, so how are you following so far? We'll have more of the various measuring instruments after the short break. Don't go away. Welcome back to Physics in Everyday Life. So, fellow physics teachers, to continue with our topic, let's move on to electrical measurements. Electric current is measured by an ammeter. So this is an ammeter, and its base unit is the ampere. Let's take a look at this DC ammeter, and we can see that it has a scale from -1 to +5 here. And each unit interval has 10 smaller divisions right here. In the upper portion of the ammeter are the terminals. So we have the red one, which corresponds to the positive terminal, and the black ones, these three, are the negative terminals. Note that different negative terminals correspond to different scale ranges, thus connecting the 50 milliamp negative terminal to the positive terminal would change the scale range from -10 milliamp to 50 milliamp. Also, connecting the 500 milliamp terminal to the positive terminal would change the scale range from -100 milliamp to +500 milliamp, and so on. So remember, always instruct your students during laboratory sessions to exercise care in connecting the ammeter in the circuit. First, it should be connected in series with the load of the circuit. Next, the positive terminal must be connected directly or indirectly with the positive terminal of the voltage source. And finally, the largest range, negative range, must be used, especially if you have no idea at first as to what amount of current is in the circuit. Another instrument is the voltmeter. The voltmeter here is used in measuring voltage, and the principle in using the instrument is the same as that of the ammeter, except that it should be connected across the load whose voltage or potential difference is to be measured. Finally, we have the multitester here. The upper part of the multitester scale is for resistance, while the lower part is for voltage and electric current. Below it is the selector switch. Note that there are four scales: the DC current, the DC voltage, the AC voltage, and the resistance. If DC current is to be measured, set the selector switch to the DC current. If pointer is at the 60 milliamp range, the uppermost scale for voltage and current should be used. Each division would be 10 units. If the pointer is at the 300 milliamp range, the middle scale should be used. Each division would now be 50 units. Now, for measuring DC voltage, simply set the selector switch to DCV. To measure resistance, set the selector switch to the resistance scale. The appropriate range for the resistance of 2 kilo ohms and below is usually R times 1. Now, in using the multitester, use the red probe on the positive socket and the black probe on the negative or comb. Plug the probes firmly. Loose probes may be dangerous, when high voltages are being measured. Before using your multimeter, make sure that the pointer is at the zero mark. Remove the dry cells from the multimeter if it is not in use for long periods. All right, physics teachers, let's now take a look at time measuring equipments. We have mechanical watches, pendulum and spring-driven clocks and watches, electrical and electronic watches, as well as atomic clocks are some of the many time measuring devices available to modern man these days. Most clocks and watches these days are controlled by electrical signals emitted by quartz crystals in the circuitry. These timers are accurate to within 1 second in 10 years. The atomic clock is the most accurate clock of all. It depends on the natural vibration of electromagnetic radiation emitted or absorbed by atoms. All right, fellow physics teachers, let us summarize the important points in today's discussion. Different laboratory instruments measure different quantities. A thermometer measures temperature, a balance measures mass, a stopwatch here measures time, a meter stick measures length, balances are used for measuring mass and weight, and the triple beam balance and the platform balances are used to measure mass, while the spring balance is used to measure weight. Electrical meters, such as ammeter, voltmeter, multimeter, multitesters, will have to be connected correctly in a given circuit to avoid damage to the meter. In reading and recording measurements, the precision of the measuring instrument should be reflected. The recorded measurement should have only as many significant figures as the scale would allow. For our next episode, we will be using timing devices that will measure very short time intervals. This will enable us to create a pictorial representation of the motion of bodies, and we hope you'll be able to join us in this very interesting topic. Till then, this is Dr. Zeny Domingo inviting you to explore the world of physics in everyday life. Good day to all our friends and colleagues out there. Welcome to our program. We all know that physics is a quantitative science. And last time, you were introduced to measurement. The lesson enabled you to identify the laboratory equipment used for measuring different physical quantities. In today's episode, we will be using length and time measuring devices in our study of motion. In our study of motion, we seek to answer the following questions. First, how do bodies move? And second, why do they move the way they do? Today we will answer the first question. We will describe how bodies move in this episode of Physics in Everyday Life. that the body has moved if it has changed position over a given time. We can describe motion as either fast or slow, but these are relative terms. What is fast to one observer may be slow to another. Therefore, a more quantitative description is required. In quantitative terms, we describe motion of a body by giving it speed. Now, speed is the ratio of how far a body has traveled or the distance traveled over how long it took to traverse that distance. So, in here we have the speed is equal to distance traveled divided by the elapsed time. In symbols, we write that as delta S over delta T, where delta S is the distance traveled, delta T is the elapsed time. Delta means the change in. In track and field, for instance, in the 100 meter dash, the winner is the sprinter who clocks the shortest time because his speed is the greatest. A runner does not move with the same speed all throughout the race. He starts at zero, speeds up at the sound of the gun, and would run at varying speeds until he reaches the finish line. To describe the runner's motion, his average speed is given. Now, physics teachers, we have another definition to make. Average speed. Average speed is the total distance traveled divided by the total time. And for the runner considered, his average speed will be equal to 100 meters divided by 10 seconds, and that for that amounts to 10 meters per second. Vehicles, like cars, have in their instrument panels a meter called the speedometer that reads the car's speed at any given time. These two cars have the same speedometer readings, but they are headed in opposite directions. So, to give a complete description of each car's motion, it is important to indicate the direction of the motion. So one car is moving 20 kilometers per hour east, and the other car moves 20 kilometers per hour west. A description of how fast the car is going and which direction it is headed is referred to as velocity. Such quantity, which has both magnitude and direction, like velocity, is called a vector quantity. On the other hand, speed, which has magnitude only, is called a scalar quantity. In simples, the speed is symbolized by the letter V, while velocity, which is a vector quantity, has the same letter V, but with an arrow on top. Now, how do we measure average velocity? Okay, we have a cyclist here, and suppose the cyclist travels a straight path to the east, like this, and he goes back to the finish line, which is at the 40 meter mark. Okay, now we can see that the total distance traveled by the cyclist from the starting line to the 100 meter mark up to the finish line is 160 meters. If he travels this in a time of 20 seconds, therefore the average speed is equal to 160 meters divided by 20 seconds, which is 8 meters per second. Now, given the average speed, we are faced with other questions, like in what direction did he move, where is he after 20 seconds, and from the given situation at the end of 20 seconds, the cyclist is 40 meters east of the starting point. In physics terms, we could say that his displacement is 40 meters east of the starting point. Okay, so now we encounter another term that needs to be defined and explained. Displacement. What is it and how is it related to velocity? More on this when we return. So, fellow physics teachers, welcome back to the show. To pick up from where we left off, what is displacement. Displacement is the change in position with respect to a reference position. It is the straight line distance from the reference position to the final position. And it is represented by an arrow, this particular arrow, up to the finish line here. The cyclist's average velocity is the ratio of the displacement and the time taken. Okay, so the average velocity is equal to delta S, which is the displacement, over delta T, and that is 40 meters east divided by 20 seconds. Therefore, if you compute that, the average velocity is equal to 2 meters per second east. Now, supposing the starting and the finish lines are the same, what is a cyclist's displacement at the end of his trip? And what is his velocity? Displacement, like velocity, is a vector quantity. Both have magnitude and direction. On the other hand, distance and speed are scalar quantities. Now, as you can see from our previous examples, the magnitude of the displacement is not equal to the distance, nor is the speed equal to the magnitude of the velocity. The distance is equal to the magnitude of the displacement, and the speed is equal to the magnitude of the velocity only when a body moves in a straight line in one direction. So you can see here from our example, we have written down, this is your distance, which is 160 meters, and this is your displacement, which is 40 meters east. On the other hand, your speed is 8 meters per second, while the velocity is equal to 2 meters per second east. A runner is concerned with how fast he is running. That is speed. On the other hand, the car driver is concerned with how fast he is going and the direction he is headed for. That is velocity. Well, physics teachers, shall we continue? To determine velocity, measurements of both displacement and time are needed. Displacement is quite easy to measure with precision, but the measurement of time is much more difficult. For motion over longer time intervals, a stopwatch like this can be used. But for shorter intervals of time, of let's say 1 second or less, it is more convenient to use a ticker timer, an electronic timer, or multi-image photography that is given by this stroboscope system. A multi-image photograph or a ticker tape record that gives a printed record of the body's motion is shown on your screen. Now, a ticker timer is a convenient way of measuring velocity over short time intervals. Here, one end of a piece of paper is attached to a moving object. In this case, it's attached to this particular block here. And the other end is passed through the ticker timer under a piece of carbon paper. A hammer that strikes the carbon paper and the tape at regular time intervals are also shown here. This prints a series of dots on the tape, like this, and these dots provide information about the motion of the object. The number of dots printed in a unit time is a timer's frequency, and the time interval to print two successive dots is the timer's period. So, let's roll this card here, turn the power on, and remove this. We have a sample here of a ticker tape representing the motion of a particular object. For your convenience, we have mounted several records on this particular board. All right, now, let's look at this tape. This tape records the motion of different objects. What can you say about the motion represented by each tape? What kind of motion is represented by equally spaced dots, like this one here? By increasing spaces between dots, like this one here? Or by decreasing separation between the dots, like the last one here. Equal separation of dots represent equal distances traveled in equal intervals of time. This means that the body traveled with constant speed. The greater the separation of the dots, the greater the constant speed. Unequal spacing between dots, on the other hand, represent unequal distances traveled in equal intervals of time. This means that the body traveled with changing speed. Increasing distance of separation between dots represent increasing speed, while decreasing distance of separation represents decreasing speed. In multiple image photography, like this, a camera takes pictures of a moving body with the use of flashing lights, like this from a stroboscopic lamp. The lamp flashes at regular intervals, and each flash lasts only for a very short while. Each flash results in an image in the photograph. Okay, if for example the lamp flashes 1,200 times in 1 minute, then the time interval between images is 1 over 1,200 of a minute, or if you convert that to seconds, that will be equal to 1 over 20 or 0.05 seconds. Okay, as before, the separation between the successive images here represents the distance traveled per unit time. We shall have more on velocity when we return. So, fellow physics teachers, we're back. And let's take a look at these pictures. Now, what do these pictures tell you about the motion of the bodies? What do you notice about the spaces between the images? And what can you say about the direction of motion? Also, what can be said about their velocities? Take a look at this photograph. This photograph shows a car moving at constant speed. Now this one down here is a photograph of a body which is moving in circular motion. Notice that the distance of separation between the consecutive images are the same. And this means that the speed of the body is constant. Note, however, that the direction of motion changes for each time interval. So, although the speed is constant, the velocity is not constant. The body's displacement changes direction. It moved with changing velocity because the direction of motion changes with time. Okay, now, let's take a look at this photograph here. This is a photograph of a freely falling body. And you may have noticed that the body moved in only one direction, and that is downwards. But the distance at each time interval increases with time. Hence, the body moved with changing velocity. Let's take a look at this system here. This is called a simple pendulum. We can make it move by displacing the body a little bit to this side and releasing it. So here's another type of motion, the motion of a simple pendulum. Now here, we can see here the photograph of a body moving with changing velocity. So, my dear physics teachers, what did this episode teach us? In today's lesson, we learned that to describe the motion of a body, we can specify the distance traveled, the displacement, the speed, and the velocity in a given time interval. To review our definitions, distance is the length of the path traveled. Displacement is the change in position with respect to a reference point. It is the straight line distance from the reference point to the final position. Speed is the description of how fast the body is moving. And finally, velocity gives a description of how fast and in which way a body is moving. Now, from printed records of motion, such as the ticker tape records or multi-flash photographs, the body's motion can be inferred. equally spaced dots or images mean the body is moving with constant speed. Unequal spacing or changing direction of motion means the velocity is changing. So, how can today's lesson be applicable to everyday life for us and our students? For one, knowing concepts in motion and how to tell direction will help us find our way when we are lost or to locate a place when given a map. It allows us to make fairly accurate estimate of the distance between two places given the average speed and the estimated time to reach the place. And given the estimated distance from one point of origin to a point of destination and the given estimated average speed, we can easily derive an estimated time of arrival. So you see, we can always assure our students that once concepts in physics are understood and applied properly, they can be useful to our day-to-day existence. Next time, we will make pictorial representations of the motion of bodies using the ticker tape record of the motion. We will also describe motion of bodies in terms of tape charts, line graphs, and equations. So, till next week then, this is Dr. Zenny Domingo for the first TV program for physics, for physics teachers like us, Physics in Everyday Life. Have a good day. Bye. Welcome once again, fellow teachers, to Physics in Everyday Life. If you remember last week, we discussed how bodies move by giving the distance they have traveled or the displacement from a reference point in a given time interval. How fast a body moves was described in terms of average speed, the ratio of total distance traveled to the time interval. It is represented by this equation. V average, or average speed, is equal to delta S over delta T, where delta S is the distance traveled and delta T is the time interval. A more complete description was in terms of average velocity, how fast the body traveled and in what direction it was going. Average velocity is the ratio of displacement over the time. Or in equation form, V average, which is a vector quantity, is equal to the displacement divided by time, or delta S vector, over delta T. Today we will discuss the geometrical interpretation of these concepts with the use of graphs. Graphing is an essential skill in learning physics. The focus of today's episode is making and interpreting graphs. At the end of this lesson, you should be able to translate data from one form to another, from multi-flash photographs to line graphs and to equations. secretive records like this, and multi-image photos are pictorial representations of the motion of bodies. They provide a convenient way of analyzing motion. Using data from these records, we will construct graphs. Graphs of position versus time and velocity versus time are also pictorial representations of motion. In this lesson, fellow teachers, we will consider straight line motion only. We will use the ticker timer to make a record of the motion of a cart. But first, we will calculate the time interval of prints between successive dots. So we would like to call Mang Frank again, who is here with us, to assist us in our demonstration. We have the ticker tape set up here, the power supply, and I will use the timer, and we will do the experiment. So, shall we start, Mang Frank? Start. Stop. The tape will now be evaluated, and we'd like to show you the resulting tape here. Here is the resulting tape, and consult.